نعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كلام الله تعالى، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. أما بعد، فهذا المجلس الذي نحن فيه الآن رتب في برنامج هذا اللقاء أنه نصيحة للنساء كفقرة أولى، تعقبها أسئلة للنساء أيضا. وحق للنساء في أعناق أزواجهن وأبنائهن وإخوانهن أن يكون لهن نصيب كمثل هذا النصيب إن شاء الله، حتى يعلمن ما للمرأة من مكانة في هذا الدين العظيم وفي قاعدة العلم والدعوة إلى الله تبارك وتعالى.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. The Sheikh first began by giving the sermon of need, which begins as indeed, we praise the name of Allah, we glorify Him, and we seek refuge in Him, and we seek aid in Him. We seek refuge in Him from the evils of ourselves and the evils of our own actions. And we testify that none has the right to be worshipped except Allah alone. And we testify that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the messenger and his slave. And the Shaykh, completed the khutbatul, the prayer of need. And then he went on to say that this gathering has been formed in the program that has been kept by the brothers in this masjid and has been addressed to the sisters who are attending. And it is a general nasiha to the sisters who are attending, and which will be followed by some questions which have been forwarded by the sisters to the brothers, the Sheikh Ali Hassan Al-Halabi and Sheikh Abu Anas. And the Sheikh then went on to say that it is the right, the right of the sisters that they know of the duties of that they have over their husbands and their children, and that they attain and achieve a high and fair proportion of the ilm of the Shari about this, that they are upon bayina, upon clear guidance.
وهذه النصيحة وإن كانت كما قلت مختصة بالنساء وموجهة لهن على وجه الخصوص، لكنها من حيث الثمرة عامة للرجال والنساء. فإن ما خطبت به المرأة من أحكام وواجبات وحقوق فهو في الجملة لا يخرج عما خطب به الرجال إلا بدليل يستثني المرأة من خطاب الرجال. والرسول عليه أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم يقول: إنما النساء شقائق الرجال. لذلك فإن هذه الكلمات التي ستكون مني إن شاء الله نصحا وتوجيها للنساء خاصة، فإن الرجال في هذه الكلمة يكونون بالتبعية من حيث وجوب استماع النصيحة، ومن حيث أنها وجهت لهم هذه النصيحة أيضا ولو بطريقة غير مباشرة.
So the Sheikh then went on to say that although this nasiha is particularized to the sisters and that it will be addressed directly to them, that doesn't mean that it is solely for them. Rather, the generality and the fruits and benefits of this nasiha encompasses and includes both the sisters and the men, i.e. the brothers. Because the addresses, when in the Quran and in the Sunnah, whenever the sisters and the women were addressed by certain rules and regulations, in generality, this address was also addressed to the men. And so one ayah which referred to the woman also referred to the men. And this is the general case with the Sharia, apart from when there is an evidence from the Quran and from the Sunnah that this address or from Allah or from the Messenger is particular to the women folk. And the Sheikh then went on to mention a proof to say that they both share in the addressees of the message. And this was that indeed women are the queen of the men. And he said that because of this fact, although it will be restricted or angled or directed to the sisters, it will also be directed to the brothers who are here, in the sense that they should follow and listen to what is there, and also that they can benefit from what has been said, because it is also general, as we have understood previously.
Wallahu tabaraka wa ta'ala, عندما قال في كتابه يا أيها الذين آمنوا قوا أنفسكم وأهليكم نارا وقودها الناس والحجارة، كان الخطاب عاما لكل المؤمنين، فالنساء لا شك داخلات في طي هذا الأمر ومن خلاله وعبره. والنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم عندما قال كلكم راع وكلكم مسؤول عن رعيته، ذكر المرأة وأنها راعية في بيتها ومسؤولة عن رعيتها.
Then the Sheikh went on to mention the verse. It says, "Oh, you who believe, save yourself from the fire and your families, and beware of the fire and the fire which has been prepared for men and for the stones." Then he went on to say that this verse was addressed to every Muslim, and it was not just sent down to the Nisa, but was addressed to every Muslim and every believer, and from these believers are the women in particular. And then therefore they included in the address of this verse. Then he went on to quote the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, in which the Prophet said that every one of you is a shepherd, and every one of you is responsible for the flock that he's shepherding. And that is the famous hadith. And again, this hadith mentioned that the woman is a shepherd and responsible over her flock, and in particular it refers to the household.
وحتى يكون الوقت في هذه المحاضرة نافعا إن شاء الله، وما يقال فيها مفيدا بمنة الله، فإني سأسوق القول في نصيحة هذه على هيئة نقاط. أما النقطة الأولى فإنها نصيحة للأخوات في الله أن يتقبلن النصيحة، فإن بعض النسوة، وأذكر أنني أقول مخاطبا النساء وإلا فإن الكلام للرجال والنساء على حد سواء، فإن بعض النسوة قد تعدد الواحدة منهن من تنصحها أو ينصحها بأنه ينتقدها أو يطعن فيها أو يجرحها، فيجب التفريق بين النصح والتجريح، بين الكلمة التي فيها تذكير وتوجيه وبين الكلام الذي فيه الطعن والإقذاع والشدة في الحكم. نعم.
And the Sheikh then went on to say that so that we can benefit the most from this short time and gain the best fruits and fawaid, he said that he would portray his words in the form of a cloak, ali, very short and sharp. And then he went on to say that the first nasiha to the sisters, and then he went on to say that, okay, this includes, and he remembers that although it is for sisters, it is also included for the brothers here. And his first thing is that acceptance, that they accept the nasiha when it is given to them. Because he remembers, and this is not imparted to any particular person, but that some people, when you give them nasiha, or some sisters, when you give them nasiha, they take it as being you criticize them, and therefore they don't accept this. Therefore he says that it is, you know, it is upon us to, whenever we are given nasiha, to accept this nasiha and to differentiate, to make the difference between a nasiha, an advice, and between when someone comes to criticize us, or when someone comes to talk us good, and from the times when they deem bad. And he went on to give several similes, several different words which have the same meaning to these just.
وأما النقطة الثانية فهي النصح بأن تتميز الأخت المسلمة في هذا المجتمع الذي ابتليت فيه، وتميزها يكون بعفتها وطهرها وحجابها والتزامها دون أن تكون متأثرة بهذه المدنية والحضارة التي كثير منها كاذب، ليس يفيد المدنية في شيء ولا ينفع البشرية في شيء. من أجل ذلك فإن الواجب على الأخت المسلمة بنتا كانت أم زوجة أم أختا أم أما أن تكون مؤثرة لا متأثرة، وليس ينبع مثل هذا التأثير، ولا أقول التأثر، مثل هذا التأثير إلا بوجود الشخصية التي تميزها بسبب التزامها وثباتها على أمر ربها تبارك وتعالى.
And thus the second nasiha given by the Shaykh is that the nasiha of differing or being different and being distinctive from, especially in this country of Kufr that they live in, and especially in this community and society that they live in. This difference or this being distinctive comes in the form of her modesty, how she carries herself, the hijab, the purity that she has, and manifesting all these features in differing from the mujtama that she lives in. Particularly because they live in a country or in a community and a society which tries to affect the individual, and affect the individual in many different ways. And the Shaykh went on to then say that that the sister should become one who affects the society and not one who has become affected by the society. The one who affects the society, and she is not influenced by it, but she makes the influence. Likewise, he went on to say this is the same for whether it be a young girl, a youth who is a female, or whether she is a wife or anything of that nature.
ومن الأمور التي تنصح بها النسوة ويذكرنا فيها إحسان العشرة، وإحسان العشرة مبناه أمران، أما أولهما فإحسان العشرة إلى الزوج وذلك كائن بطاعته وعدم مخالفته وحفظه في السر والعلن. فالمرأة المؤمنة هي كما قال الرسول عليه الصلاة والسلام هي خير متاع يحوزه المؤمن. خير متاع يحوزه المؤمن المرأة الصالحة. وكذلك إحسان العشرة إلى الأبناء بنات وأولادا، وهذا يكون بالتربية الربانية الجادة المبنية على المعرفة الصحيحة وعلى كتاب الله وسنة رسوله صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم، ليعيش هؤلاء الأبناء حياتهم الدينية منذ الصغر لينشأوا عليها ويشبوا على أحكامها، فلا يتأثرون بل يكونون أيضا مؤثرين. وبالنسبة للأبناء فإني أخص بالذكر البنات لما تعتري حياتهن من مخاطر شديدة وشديدة جدا، وبخاصة في هذه البلاد الذي ابتليتم أو التي ابتليتم بالعيش فيها، فإن القوانين والنظم كلها تعين على الإثم وتساعد على الانحراف وتقوي عزم أي بنت على أن تخالف أمر والدها وطاعة والدتها وأوامر ربها من قبل ومن بعد. فيجب على الأمهات، فيجب على النساء أن يراقبن البنات مراقبة دقيقة عميقة، وأن يتنبهن إلى تصرفاتهن وأخلاقهن حتى يكن ملتزمات ومتربيات التربية الربانية الحقيقية التي يريدها الله تبارك وتعالى من الأم أو من المرأة بنتا وأما وأختا وزوجة.
And from the matters of nasiha to the sisters is good ishra, good companionship that she has with her constantly. And this good companionship has two features. The first feature is good companionship or good ishra with the husband, and this entails obedience to him and not disobeying him and not going against his wishes and his desires, as well as protecting his property and his honor, whether in the open or hiddenly or secretly. And this then went on to, the Shaykh then went on to mention a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in which he said, the best the best comfort that one can have or man can have and that he can benefit with in this dunya is, and the hadith mentioned three things but the Shaykh mentioned only one, is a righteous, pious wife. And he then went on to say that the ishra and his good companionship, the second part is with the children, both the boys and the young girls. And this involves cultivating them, bringing them up and educating them. And this tarbiyah, this cultivation should be a cultivation which is rabbani, which is based upon the methods of the ulama, or the word Rabbani has various meanings, but it is a cultivation in which you cultivate and nurture the child step by step approach. And also throughout their life, because from the time that they are young, they are affected by many numerous things. And he also then went on to particularize that this tarbiyah, or this cultivation for the sisters in particular, they should take note and be aware and look more towards the young daughters that they have. And he mentioned this in particular because that they are faced by more dangers, and that because it is easier for them in such a society that they live in, easy for them to go against the commands, or easy for them to be misled, and easy for them to fall astray by the numerous things that this community and this society invites them to. So he then went on to say that because of this fact, the mothers should pay good attention towards the upbringing of the daughters, such that they can look at them and they can also make the children affect and not be affected by the society. And the daughters again, make them of those who are affected, those who affect and not are affected by the society. And therefore they, from a young age, they grow up within the obedience and within the right environment.
ومن باب حسن العشرة تذكير النساء وبخاصة منهن الزوجات بالتأني والتمهل والهدوء في معالجة المشاكل العائلية، وبخاصة منها ما كان مع الزوج، فإن المرأة بما خلقها الله عليه فإنها سريعة الانفعال وسريعة التأثر، فيخشى أن ترتكب امرأة ما مخالفة، بل مخالفات، بل ما قد يكون أكثر من ذلك إذا سخطت على زوجها أو غضبت من تصرف منه أو ما شابه ذلك، فيؤدي هذا التصرع وذلك الانفعال إلى دمار أسرتها وتشرد أبنائها وتشتت بناتها، وهذا كله يؤدي إلى هدم الأسرة وإلى البعد عن ما يرضي الله تبارك وتعالى. فالواجب على هذه المرأة التي نصحناها بالتأني والتمهل أن ترجع بهذه المشكلة إلى من تثق به من طلاب العلم، من إخوانها في الله، ترجع إلى أخت لها في الله لها زوج صالح إن شاء الله يكون ذا قدرة على حل المشكلات. وقد من الله عليكم في هذا البلد بفضيلة الشيخ صهيب حسن حفظه الله، وهو رجل من أهل العلم ومن أهل السنة، وهو بمثابة الوالد والأب لكم جميعا، فيجب أن لا تبخلوا على أنفسكم بعدم الذهاب إليه ومناصحته واستنصاحه وطلب توجيهاته، وإني لواثق إن شاء الله أنه لن يبخل عليكم بتذكير أو بيان أو نصح أو توجيه. فإذا فعلتم وفعلتن ذلك جميعا فإن هذا سيكون له أكبر الأثر في حفظ الأسرة وفي حفظ الزوج وفي حفظ الأبناء، بما يعين إن شاء الله على حدود الطاعة وإطارها.
And the Sheikh then all went on to say that he would like to remind the sisters, and in particularly the sisters who are married, of the feature of not being hasty, of slowing down, of taking their time in matters and in problems that they may face with regard to problems that they have, in particular problems of the family and any problems that they may face with regard to their husband. Because woman by nature is rash and can act rashly. And this kind of action, whether it's internal or external, can lead to more harm than good. So, and this can then lead on to her destruction or a diminishing or reducing the love and the bond of the family. And this can then lead on to destruction of the family itself, right, into a breakage of the marriage and into that which Allah does not like and other things of this nature. So upon and in this situation, it is the duty and the responsibility of the sister that she refers back to somebody who she trusts as talib of knowledge, a student of knowledge, whether it is a brother or a sister who she trusts, and to go back to them and seek their advice on these matters. And then after this, you know, going back to them and going and seeking and solving the problem in this matter rather than acting hastily. And then Sheikh went on to say that Allah has blessed us and both the sisters and the brothers by having Sheikh Suhaib Hassan living in this country with us, where he is a very knowledgeable brother and a brother who is from Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, from Salafiyyah. And he's like a father figure to you. So I'm sure that he will not, and brothers and sisters should not feel shy or be respondent or negligent of going to him, and rather we should go to him and seek his nasiha. Because the Sheikh said that he's sure that the Sheikh will not be miserly in giving us advice. He will give us advice and nasiha and guidance whenever we go to him and seek him. And therefore we should not close this door and this avenue of using Sheikh Suhaib. Because from the best ways of this will be from the best ways of keeping the family united and keeping the children and the whole family feeling in a good Islamic manner.
والنقطة الرابعة التي أذكرها ناصحا أخواتي في الله هي المحافظة على الطاعات. والطاعات تقسم إلى قسمين: فرائض ونوافل. أما الفرائض فأعظمها الصلوات الخمس وأداؤها في أوقاتها، فإني أعلم بالخبرة والتجربة والخبر الصادق أن كثيرا من النسوة يؤخرن الصلاة ويتساهلن في أداء الفرائض في أوقاتها، وقد يكون ذلك بسبب انشغال في طبيخ أو في تربية أو في غسيل أو في شيء من شؤون البيت، لكن هذا كله أمر لا ينتهي وسهل قضاؤه وأداؤه فيما بعد. لكن الصلاة يقول فيها الرسول عليه الصلاة والسلام: من ترك صلاة العصر فقد حبط عمله. والرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول: لا تتركن صلاة متعمدا، وإن قطعت وصلبت وحرقت. وهذا الذي يتساهل، أو هذه الأخت التي تتساهل في الصلاة وتظل تسوف وتؤخر وتؤجل حتى يذهب وقت الصلاة ويفوت، فإنها يجب عليها أن تعلم أن هذا فعل منها شبه عمد، فيجب عليها أن تتقي الله تبارك وتعالى. ومن الفرائض أيضا صيام رمضان والحج والزكاة لمن ملكت نصاب المال الواجب، وكذلك من الطاعات النوافل من صلاة سنة أو نافلة مطلقة أو صدقة أو صوم، مع التنبيه هنا على مسألة فقهية تخطئ فيها كثير من النساء، وهي أن صيام النافلة وكذلك صدقة النافلة مما لا يجوز للمرأة أن تفعله أو أن تقوم به إلا بإذن زوجها، إلا بإذن زوجها. ونحن لا نشترط أن يكون الإذن صريحا في كل يوم بيوم، وإنما لو كان إذنا عاما ضمنيا بأن يقول لها زوجها تصدقي حيث شئت لمن شئت في الوقت الذي ترين أو ترين فيه الواجب أو الأمر واجبا. وكذلك الصدقة أو عفوا الصيام، أن يجيز لها الصيام نافلة في الوقت الذي ترى فيه نفسها مقبلة على هذه العبادة ومحبة لهذه الطاعة، فهذا كله يبين لزوم محافظة المرأة على الطاعات فرائضها ونوافلها.
And the fourth point which is mentioned by the Shaykh is safeguarding upon and being constant upon obedience or acts of obedience, ta'at. And these acts of obedience fall into two categories, those which are compulsory and those which are not compulsory. And those which are compulsory, from the greatest of them, is the other five daily prayers, and being regular upon them, upon their time, and in the best manners. And the Shaykh said that he knows, and he is referring to that he knows that many sisters, and this includes brothers, but he knows that many sisters, they become negligent in praying these prayers upon their time because of various reasons, maybe due to slight laziness, maybe due to the being occupied in the home or matters of this nature. And then he said that whatever it may be, it is not befitting that this is the case, that they neglect or they delay the prayer for such reasons, because of several hadith. From them, just 42 of them, from them is that whoever of you leaves the Salatul Asr, the Asr prayer, then his acts will be nullified or not accepted. And another hadith, do not... Do not deliberately or do not intentionally leave the prayer, even if you do not intentionally leave the prayer, even if you are crucified or punished, if you are burnt or if you are punished in any other form or fashion. Words used in Arabic and it's to lift and it's to be punished and put on a cross and be punished or to be burnt. And this is a form of punishment. So the wording used in the hadith is Lata Turkanna, which is shows a great emphasis. So again, these two hadith show the importance of not becoming negligent and not delaying the prayer from their time. And also from leaving them intentionally. Because once you start delaying, and for other reasons, it's as if you intentionally delay or intentionally stop praying the prayer on its right time, in its right fashion, and being constant upon this thing. And then he went on to mention the second form of obedience to Allah, which is from the nawafil. and from the voluntary acts which one can do. And this is impartly to the sisters, and they can fast, I can give zakat, and other nature, and they should be encouraged to do so. But here, the Shaykh wants to point to or highlight to a fact or to a tricky matter in which many sisters, they err and they become mistaken. And that, and this regards to fasting and giving sadaqah, which are voluntary. And that is that if they want to do so, they want to give sadaqah or they want to fast, a voluntary fast, and they should get the permission of their husband in these two matters. And he then goes on to say that this doesn't mean that they, for the sadaqah, before they give sadaqah, they get the permission of the husband. This doesn't mean that we have to have a clear, open, unequivocal permission, but as long as he knows and he's aware, and you, and he's told, then you can give sadaqah from his, the wealth of his, and in the best way you think, but the permission is required. And also, this doesn't mean every day and every time, but once he's give it to you, for a month maybe then again. And then he went to talk about fasting, and again, the sisters, before they fast their voluntary fast, they should ask, and when they feel that they want to keep a voluntary fast, they should ask the husband if they can do so. And this, in this fashion, they will be able to comply with obeying Allah properly, and also obeying the husbands and keeping the good companionship there. And this then clears to us, you know, the rights of each other, or that the husband has upon the wife.
والنقطة الأخيرة التي أختم بها نصيحتي لأخواتي في الله هي استغلال الأوقات في المجالس. فكم من الأوقات والساعات تضيع من غير فائدة وتذهب سدى بلا مردود إيماني أو علمي أو أخلاقي. تضيع الأوقات بالكلام في الدنيا وزخارفها الفانية. ولو أننا بقي الحد عندنا إلى هذا لسهل، لكنه أحيانا يزداد ويتوسع حتى يصل إلى الغيبة والنميمة والقول بلا علم. فالواجب على أخواتنا المؤمنات الصالحات أن يتقين الله في أنفسهن، وأن يحفظن ألسنتهن، وأن يراقبن الله في أعمالهن، وأن يستغللن أوقاتهن في الأعمال الصالحة، في حفظ آيات من كتاب الله، أو مدرسة شيء من أحاديث رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم، أو معرفة بعض أمور الفقه التي يتفقهن بها في دينهن، فإن ذلك كله إن شاء الله سيعينهن على حمل الرسالة الغالية العظيمة العزيزة التي أناط الله بهن في بناء الأسرة وحماية المجتمع. فإذا المرأة صارت صالحة فإن المجتمع سيصلح. لماذا؟ لأن المرأة بنت وأخت وأم وزوجة. فتخيلوا بالله عليكم لو أن هذه الأم وتلك البنت وهذه الأخت وتلك الزوجة أصبحن صالحات مصلحات مربيات قائمات عابدات صائمات قانتات، ماذا يصير في هذا المجتمع الذي تكون فيه الراية محمولة لأمثال هذه الفئة الطيبة؟ لا شك ولا ريب أن ذلك سيكون له الأثر البالغ في صيانة هذا المجتمع من المعاصي والآثام والفتن ما ظهر منها وما بطن. هذا أيها الأخوات، أيتها الأخوات المؤمنات وأيها الإخوة الصالحون، ما أحببت أن أختم به كلامي في هذه النصيحة الموجزة، وإن كان في النفس نصائح أخرى أبدأ بها مذكرا نفسي وأختم بها مذكرا نفسي، ولا يؤمن أحدكم حتى يحب لأخيه ما يحب لنفسه. وكما قلت ابتداء أقول انتهاء، فكما أن الخطاب للنساء فهو كذلك للرجال سواء بسواء. وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين، وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين.
And the final point, or the final matter which the Sheikh wants to mention with regard to the nasiha to the sisters, is that they occupy their time and spend their time, or he says normally they spend their time in matters which are not beneficial. So he advised them to spend their time in matters which are beneficial, because he knows that more or less most of us, and particularly his brothers, we spend our time in talking and in things which are not beneficial. We may spend that time which sometimes may reach the level of riba, the level of spreading rumors and slander, the level of speaking about the deen of Allah without any knowledge. So this is it. And also they may spend their time talking about matters which have no benefit, or which have no knowledge, which have no effect upon the akhlaq, upon the characters and their manners. So if this is the case, then they should avoid these things and rather spend their time, occupy their time by righteous deeds, by memorizing the Quran, memorizing some ahadith, some the sayings of the Prophet ﷺ, and memorizing and revising some matters of fiqh, or the halal and haram, and matters of fiqh that are connected to them in particular, so that they can be aware of what is connected to them from the deen of Islam. And these matters, when they discuss and they gather, if they can discuss these things, then it will help them in being able to carry this message of Islam, and this message that they are, and our sisters, obliged to carry. And also the Sheikh went on to say that he says that this is important, and if the women folk become rectified and reformed, then the Ummah will become rectified and reformed. And why is this the case? This is the case because the sisters are sisters, I mean blood sisters, our children, our daughters, or our mothers, or one of us. So because they form such a crucial part of the society, if they could become reformed, then it would become a great big step in reforming the community as a whole, because they will have a unique impact upon the family and the children. And he says, he ends his nasiha, although it's very short, with these 4 or 5 points, and although he would have many, many more that he would like to say, but inshallah he keeps them to himself, and he ends as he began. And he also mentioned the hadith, you know, that whoever truly believes, then nothing, none of you truly believes until you love for yourself that which you love for your brothers. And he also said that this nasiha, it is general. As he began, he said this general, this nasiha, although it is directed to the sisters, it is also equally directed to the brothers, as you may have gathered from the points that have been mentioned. And he then closed with the final dua, and inshallah, there's no need to have it broken. And now inshallah, the sisters have given us some questions inshallah. We will direct them to the Shaykh, both Abu Anas and
mashallah.
And first inshallah Abu Anas.
هاي الأسئلة اللي جاوب عليك سجل بحط النور.
يقول الأخ okay. English says to Sheikh Ali Hassan and to Sheikh Abu Anas, can your husband command you to wear the veil? When can your husband beat his wife? And can a husband stop his wife from seeing another sister? أبو عبد العربية الشيخ يقول إلى شيخ علي حسن وشيخ أبو عنت, هل يمكن أن الزوج يأمر زوجته بلبس النقاب الجزء الأول, والثاني هل يمكن للزوج أن يضرب زوجته, والثالث يعني هل يمكن أن الزوج يمنع زوجته من لقاء يعني أختها ولم يحدد هل هو أخت إسلام أو أخت يعني شقيقة؟
يلا شيخ. شيخ علي should answer about the beating because he's tougher. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم, الحمد لله رب العالمين, والصلاة والسلام على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. حدود طاعة الزوجة لزوجها تكون في المعروف, والمعروف أيضا ينقسم إلى الواجب والمباح, ولا يجوز للزوجة أن تعصي زوجها إلا في حال المعصية. تكون واجبة لأن الزوج لم يأمر بمعصية الله عز وجل, وليس هذا موضع بسط الخلاف في النقاب هل هو واجب أم لا. أما بالنسبة للضرب فالضرب قد شرعه الله عز وجل في موطن العلاج, يقول الله تبارك وتعالى واللاتي تخافون نشوزهن فعظوهن واهجروهن في المضاجع واضربوهن فإن أطعنكم فلا تبغوا عليهن السبيل, أي أنه لا سبيل للزوج في ضرب زوجه ولا في هجرها من المضجع إلا في حال النشوز وهو العصيان. وهذا الضرب يراعى فيه أنه المقصود فيه التأديب والإصلاح وليس الانتقام والتشفي بحيث يتلف لها بعض الأعضاء. أما ما يفعله البعض من الضرب لمجرد أدنى خلاف ونقاش فهذا خروج عن العشرة بالمعروف. ولكن أيضا لابد أن نعرف أن بعض الملحدين والمستشرقين يقدح في هذا العلاج النبوي العلاج القرآني في ضرب الزوج لزوجه. وأما لقاء الأخت فإن كانت الأخت شقيقة فإن هذا من باب صلة الأرحام ومنعها يعتبر من قطيعة الأرحام وقاطع الرحم ملعون في كتاب الله ومتوعد بوعيد عظيم. لكن ينبغي أن ينظر أيضا في الحامل للزوج على المنع من زيارة أخت الزوجة إن كان ذلك يجلب المشاكل للزوجين أو تتعلم المرأة من أختها ما لا يحمد أو كانت أختها فاسدة فهذا ينظر فيه الزوج للمصالح التي تترتب على هذا. وقد تكون الزيارة ضيقة بحدود المتابعة والله أعلم.
The question of obeying the husband should be considered or recognized within the context of goodness and obedience to Allah. That is to say that a woman is obliged to obey her husband as long as he orders her in an act of righteousness and to do something which is in accordance with obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Then the Shaykh went on to say that with regard to the niqab, without going into detail, because the niqab issue is a very famous, very detailed, thick matter, but for those who are from the stance that the niqab is obligatory, then when the husband commands to wear the niqab, it falls from the category of obedience to the husband, which is wajib, and therefore she cannot disobey him. But if the person is, if you look at it from the stance of that it is not wajib but mustahab, then again, the husband has not commanded the wife to do anything which is not, or has not ordered the wife to do a sin or a sinful deed. Therefore, the wife should also obey the husband in this command of wearing the niqab. And he then went to talk about the hitting or the beating. The word beating is maybe a too harsh a word in English. That's why I don't like it. But the Sheikh quoted a verse. Sheikh, can you please read the ayah?
وَاللَّاتِ تَخَافُونَ نُشُوزَهُنَّ فَعِظُوهُنَّ وَاهْجُرُوهُنَّ فِي الْمَضَاجِعِ وَاضْرِبُوهُنَّ.
Okay.
فَإِنْ أَطَعْنَكُمْ فَلَا تَبْغُوا عَلَيْهِنَّ سَبِيلًا.
Right, and from those who those women from who you fear that they will disobey, then advise them. Then advise them and consult them and discuss with them. Then if they do not obey, then stay away from their bed with them for 3 nights. And then if they do not accept that, then beat them lightly. Yeah.
Yeah, but 3 nights I did not say.
Okay, then okay, but then stay away from having sexual relations with them. And then if still does not rectify, then beat them lightly. Like, and this verse, which is all known to you. And then, but also he mentioned many other things which unfortunately I must forgive us with the brothers and atomites.
He said that the striking of a woman should be seen as a corrective measure to rectify a situation, but under no circumstances should a woman be beaten in a way that one wants to take revenge from her, or to harm her, or to disfigure her, or to abuse her. But whenever such a measure is resorted to, it is resorted to only to correct a problem which exists.
Sheikh Ali, yeah.
We move on to the second question, inshallah, and we try, inshallah, to make it much better, inshallah. And this is to Sheikh Ali Hassan al-Halabi. He says, and in English, does the wife wait for her husband to pray the compulsory prayers, even if it means delaying her prayer? So, بِالْعَرْبِيَا أَشِيْءَ أُخْتِيَكُوا الْحَلْ أَزْوَجَةُ يَنْتَذِرْ لِلْزَوْجَ حَتَى يُصَلِّي صَلَاةَ الْفَرْضِ وَإِنْ نَفَجَ مِنْ ذَلِكَ أَنَّهِ هِيَ تُؤَخِّرْ الصَّلَاةَ مِنْ وَقْتِهَا.
يعني إيش wait for the day؟ يعني لا تصلي حتى يصلي هو
أو يعتذر له وإن حصل من ذلك أنك تؤخر الصلاة أن يقال أن هذا
نحن
ما ندري يعني هل ممكن بعدكم أن
نجاوب على جملة الجواب أن الأصل أن يصلي الرجل في المسجد، ولكن على فرض أنه لم يصلي في المسجد لسبب أو لآخر، فحينئذ يصلي الرجل في أهل بيته، فهذا هو الأصل. الأصل الصلاة جماعة مع أهل البيت. فإن كان أيضا هناك عذر يمنع من أداء هذه الصلاة كرعاية الأبناء مثلا والخشي عليهن أو ما شابه ذلك، فالمرأة تنتظر زوجها حتى يصلي لتصلي عقبه وبعده، فحينئذ يجوز لها ذلك بشرط أن لا يكون الانتظار فاحشا أي كثيرا وكبيرا بحيث يخرج الوقت أو يقارب أو على الأقل يصل إلى وقت الكراهة في تأخير الصلاة عن وقتها. فإذا وصل الأمر إلى هذا الحد فحينئذ لا يجوز لها مثل هذا التأخير التي تخالف به أداء الصلاة على وقتها. والنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يخبر أن أحب الأعمال إلى الله أداء الصلاة في وقتها.
The Sheikh answered that the root or the origin for the man's prayer is that he should pray in the masjid, and that if for some other reason he's unable to pray in the masjid, then he should pray in his house with his family. And this is the asal, the root or the basis of the prayer. But if after that he is unable for a excuse to perform his prayer, and also sorry, the Sheikh may mention that when he prays in the house, that he should pray with his wife together. If he's unable to go to the masjid, they pray together in the home. But if for some other reason the husband is unable to perform the prayer, perhaps he may be looking after the children, or he may be seeing something may happen to them. If for some reason something like this happens and he's unable to pray at the time, then it is permissible or okay for the wife to wait for him if it doesn't entail a long wait for him, because they should pray together. But if this wait entails that then that the prayer is delayed to such a time that the time of the prayer has nearly ended, then at that point in time it's not allowed for her to do so, rather she should pray. And the Sheikh also mentioned that I referred and indicated to a hadith which said that the meaning of the hadith is that the most beloved actions to Allah is that you perform the prayer upon your times.
What's the time for so much?
Upon his time, ma'am.
What's in Sabbinam? Alhamdulillah, Rahman ibn Salah.
Wait.
And Abu Tahir. Inshallah, there were many questions from the sisters, and we all the questions, brothers and sisters, we're keeping all of them because we're going to try and answer as many as possible.